Welcome to part one of module three. In this part, we're thinking about what are the forms of evidence-based practices that we should be thinking about using within intensive intervention. So the objectives for this part of this module is we're gonna focus on what does the term evidence-based practices mean? And then we're gonna talk about the differences among different terms. So evidence-based practices, evidence-based interventions, evidence-based strategies, and then promising practices. So where are we? With this arrow, we are thinking about the start of our instructional platform. That's what I like to call this part right up here. And that instructional platform should be full of really good practices to teach mathematics to the students, because we don't want to waste a student's time. And so how do we know what are really good instructional practices? We have to rely on the evidence. So I hope that you've already read this article about taking the guesswork out of finding evidence-based practices for diverse learners, because a lot of the terminology in this article is what we're going to use on the following slides. So let's go ahead and get started. When I think about the term evidence-based practice, I think about that as an umbrella term. And so it is just amazing we have an umbrella on our slide to help think about this as our umbrella term. And the term evidence-based practice is something that has shown consistent and positive results. Now, an evidence-based practice can mean a few different things. So an evidence-based practice can mean an evidence-based intervention. So that's just one type of evidence-based practice. And an evidence-based intervention is an intervention, and often when I think about an intervention, I think about that as a packaged program. And that packaged program has shown consistent and positive results. So let's think a little bit about what these evidence-based interventions might look like. So an evidence-based intervention might look like this. So this is an evidence-based intervention from Diane Bryant and her colleagues. And this is a packaged intervention that helps students in the early elementary grades understand everything about numbers and operations. So if you look at this evidence-based intervention, it has these lesson guides and it's all prepared. And if you go from page to page, you see the different mathematics that you're supposed to teach within that evidence-based intervention. Now here's another example of an evidence-based intervention. This comes from the University of Oregon, and this was shared by Ben Clark and his colleagues at the University of Oregon. This is a technology-based evidence-based intervention, and it's focused on early numeracy. And here, if you get this evidence-based intervention, then you work through it and it has all the materials there, everything that you need to do the intervention with the student. It's all there. And it has an evidence base that shows that this intervention helps increase the mathematics performance of students when the intervention is implemented with fidelity. So it's yet another evidence-based intervention. And then here's a third example of an evidence-based intervention. This is a fraction intervention from Lynn Fuchs and her colleagues at Vanderbilt University. And this intervention, you get this packaged program and it has all of these different lessons. They're all focused on how do students understand what fractions mean, how do you order fractions, how do you compare fractions, how do you add and subtract fractions. But it's a packaged program and it has a strong evidence base. Students that participate in this intervention typically increase their knowledge related to fractions. Those are all examples of evidence-based interventions. Now, when an evidence-based intervention is not available, you can rely on our next part, which is called an evidence-based strategy. So I kind of like to think about these in order. So when you're asked to find an evidence-based practice, you should really first think, well, is there an evidence-based intervention that I can use? Because an evidence-based intervention is packaged and it has everything that you need to implement that intervention. But if that's not available for you, or it's not available at the grade level you teach, or it's just not an appropriate intervention, then you can rely on an evidence-based strategy. And an evidence-based strategy is a method or strategy that has also shown consistent and positive results. It's typically not packaged and, you know, everything's there that you need. Usually it's kind of like a smaller part of the bigger intervention puzzle. And so let me show you some examples of evidence-based strategies. Here's an evidence-based strategy. This is a strategy that has shown to increase the fact knowledge of students. And this evidence-based strategy is called cover, copy, compare. Now, you don't really buy cover, copy, compare. What you do is you read about how cover, copy, compare works, and then you make your own sheet so that the students can participate in cover, copy, compare. So it's not nicely packaged, but it still does have an evidence base. It is an evidence-based strategy. Another evidence-based strategy that we often go to in mathematics is the use of manipulatives. So this is an example of the manipulative algebra tiles. So these are the different sets of algebra tiles. And when you use algebra tiles with students, it often helps students understand different algebraic concepts, such as zero pairs and balancing. Whatever you do to one side of the equation, you also do to the other side. Now, when you buy the algebra tiles, there's usually a little bit of information about how to use them, but it isn't a packaged program. But it is a strategy, because we know that many times when students use manipulatives and when teachers explain how math works with different manipulatives, that helps increase math knowledge as well. Another evidence-based strategy is the simple strategy of using flashcards to help students increase their fact knowledge. Matt Burns and his colleagues have worked a lot on a flashcard strategy called incremental rehearsal. You can do that with any set of flashcards. You don't have to buy a specific set of flashcards. If you even make your own flashcards, you can use incremental rehearsal, and that also is an evidence-based strategy. So let's think. We've got our evidence-based interventions, which is probably where we want to start. But when those aren't available, we can think about using an evidence-based strategy. And when neither of these are available, then we could think about using a promising practice. So this is something that has a little bit of evidence, and it's shown maybe one positive result, but perhaps there's not a collection of research that supports that practice just yet, but it's getting there. So you may say okay, I'm gonna think about using this when these other two types of evidence-based practices are not available. But now there's one thing I want you to think about, and that's what not to do. We do not want to use any practices that do not have evidence. So that's why they're outside of our umbrella. And I'm actually going to put a big red X over those. So if you can't find any evidence to support an intervention, and there's no evidence to support a strategy, with an intensive intervention, we should not be using those things. That is a huge waste of your time and your students' time. I can always guarantee that there's going to be an intervention or a strategy or a promising practice that you can use to teach anything in mathematics. So please do not try to use things where you can't find the evidence that supports the use of that strategy. So here we have our umbrella of evidence-based practices. Remember again, your first option should always be to find an evidence-based intervention. If that's not available, then you can rely on evidence-based strategy or strategies. A lot of times you might combine some of those within your intensive intervention. And then if that's not available, you can rely on a promising practice. Now with those things in mind, it's time to think about doing workbook activity number one. And in workbook activity number one, you're going to look at examples of different evidence-based practices. And your job is to determine whether it's an evidence-based intervention, whether it's an evidence-based strategy, or whether it's a promising practice. So we've just done an activity related to evidence-based practices and the difference among evidence-based interventions, evidence-based strategies, and promising practices. Now, one of the questions that you might have is how do you know if something has evidence? Now, this is not a research course, all right? This is a mathematics course, so I'm not going to focus a ton on this, but I am briefly going to talk about what are some of the things that I look for if I'm thinking about whether something has evidence or not. So the first thing that I always want to think about is there assessment data that shows results? And this might come in several forms. You might see improvement from before the intervention, so perhaps there was a pretest, and then there was a post-test, and that you see that from pre to post-test, students that received the intervention or the strategy showed significant improvement. You also might see this as improvement compared to students that did not receive any of the treatment. So perhaps there's an intervention going on and we see much higher scores for students that did the intervention versus students that did not do the intervention. Now I also want to look at whether the intervention or strategy has been replicated. And replication can occur because the intervention or strategy has been used by multiple researchers. It's been tested with multiple students, perhaps students in Massachusetts and students in Ohio. And it would be even better if we also saw that it worked with students in California. And it's been done multiple times. So that could be across multiple years or at different locations. But the idea is that it hasn't just been used once, but then it's been used multiple times with multiple people and multiple students, and it still has shown the same positive results. And then the other thing that I always think about when it comes to evidence is that, does this evidence-based intervention or strategy, does it relate to the setting and students that you're teaching in? So let's say that you are a teacher in Texas and you teach out in a rural setting. If there was an intervention that was tested only with students in New York City, that might be a slightly different group of students than the students that you're working with. Now, I'm not saying that there always has to be an exact match here, but you might want to consider that. And another thing you want to think about is disability. So if there was an evidence-based intervention that was only implemented for students with autism, you might want to think about that, whether that's an appropriate intervention to use with students with learning difficulties and that type of thing. So now you're going to look at workbook activity number 2. And I want you to look at these same examples of evidence-based practices, and I want you to rate the evidence for those practices. So here we are with our DBI framework. And in this part of Module 3, we've been focusing on what evidence-based practices should be used within the start of DBI. That's our orange slight rectangle up here at the top. And it says we need to be using a validated intervention program. And validated means that it has an evidence base. And I always like to think about this part here as I like to call it the instructional platform. It's the jumping off point for the rest of our DBI framework. And that instructional platform should use an evidence-based intervention. But when that's not available, what can we use? We can use an evidence-based strategy. So you want that instructional platform to be as strong as possible for the student or students that you're working with. So you want to rely on things that have an evidence base for that to be your jumping off point for the DBI framework. So in this module, we have talked about what are the forms of evidence-based practices that might be available for use within intensive intervention. We defined the term evidence-based practices, so I hope that you feel very comfortable with that. And then we identified the differences among evidence-based interventions, evidence-based strategies, and then promising practices. So your final part, your final activity here is a discussion board, and you are going to share an example of an evidence-based intervention or strategy that you find useful in the classroom.